And today is the third Sunday of Advent, the Sunday of joy. Our joy is in God and His Son Jesus. Like hope and peace, joy too is a gift from God. It overtakes us and fills us with when we remember that God, what God has done and what He has promised to do. And so I light this third candle today to remind us that Christ came and is coming so that all people might have a rich and abundant life. We thank God for the hope He gives us, and for the peace He bestows, and for the joy He pours out into our hearts.
We are ready now to listen to the words of the Holy Gospel, the good news of Jesus for us. Please stand and join me in the Gospel acclamation.
He was not the light, but came to testify to the light. And this is the testimony of John. When the Jews from Jerusalem sent priests and Levites to him to ask him, "Who are you?" He admitted and did not deny it, but admitted, "I am not the Christ." So they asked him, "What are you then? Are you Elijah?" And he said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." So they said to him, "Who are you, so we can give an answer to those who sent us? What do you have to say for yourself?" And he said, "I am the voice of one crying out in the desert, 'Make straight the way of the Lord.'" As Isaiah the prophet said, some Pharisees were also sent, and they asked him, "Why then do you baptize if you are not the Christ, or Elijah, or the prophet?" John answered them, "I baptize with water, but there is one among you whom you do not recognize, the one who is coming after me, whose sandal strap I am not worthy to untie." This happened in Bethany, across the Jordan, where John was baptizing. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Well, we hear many beautiful Christmas songs this time of year. A refrain that keeps going through my head is from one of the Christmas songs, where the refrain is, "It's the most wonderful time of the year." You probably heard those words on your car radio or someplace. The most wonderful time of the year. In a certain way it is, in many ways, as we approach Christmas and the birth of Jesus Christ, of course. There is a sense of kind of happiness and optimism in the air at this time of year. And in fact, the liturgy of today, which is the third Sunday of Advent, Sunday we used to call it Gaudete Sunday, meaning rejoicing. We wear a different color vestment today, a little sense of celebration. So the liturgy of today reflects that sense of wonderfulness as well. Especially in the scripture readings that were just presented to you. Just want to repeat a few of those words from scripture that kind of underline the idea of rejoicing. Consider, for instance, the first reading from Isaiah, a major Old Testament prophet, who said things like this, "The Lord has sent me to bring glad tidings to the poor, to heal the brokenhearted, and to give liberty to captives." He said many other things as well, beautiful sayings, and certainly a very upbeat message. Usually, the response after the first reading, we usually read a psalm from written usually by David. But today we had a different change of pace here, where we not didn't have a psalm, but we had that beautiful prayer that our sister sang, the Magnificat, the prayer spoke by Mary as she visited her cousin Elizabeth before the birth of Jesus, when she was greeted by Elizabeth, and Mary spoke again these upbeat words, when she said again a couple of things that she said is, "My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord, and the Almighty has done great things for me." I think she was feeling pretty good at that time to say those words. In the Gospel of John, we feature John the Baptist today. He was the one who came to prepare the way for the Lord. And he, in his preaching, he raised great expectations among the people of the coming of the Messiah. Certainly gave them an upbeat message, and in fact, they thought he was the Messiah himself. And finally, in the reading from St. Paul to the Thessalonians today, he uses those words that I just used a moment ago about, he said, "Rejoice always. Again, I say to you, rejoice. And do not quench the spirit." So all the ones I mentioned are upbeat and positive about God's action in their individual lives. It sounds as if their lives were perfect, and of course they were not. They were far from perfect, and we have to consider the circumstances in which they uttered these optimistic words. For instance, consider the circumstances surrounding Isaiah in his time on earth. His people had been descending the Babylonian captivity of 50 years. It is true they had been freed, but a great journey lay ahead of them, and to go back to Jerusalem and to rebuild the temple and rebuild relationships. So it was, they were freed from slavery, but again faced a very uncertain future. And yet he could say the words about liberty and forgiveness and all those things about God redeeming them. In regard to the Blessed Mother, then you know a little bit about her story. Of course, when she went to see her cousin Elizabeth, she had very many reasons to be very anxious and nervous and perhaps a little bit depressed. She was about to become a single mother. She was kind of uncertain about the future, and she was probably a little bit worried too about her relationship with Joseph that was seemingly become unraveled a little bit at that time anyway. And yet she could say those wonderful words of the Magnificat, that how God has done great things for her. And again, John the Baptist, he was always in trouble, it seems. His life was far from perfect. It didn't take him long to get the anger of all the leaders of the people there. And finally, of course, he put him in prison. We know his story a bit, too. But finally, the story, the scriptures in which we get the name of the Sunday, Gaudete, or Rejoicing Sunday, St. Paul suffered greatly in his life. And you know, you hear about them from time to time, about his beatings at various times, his rejections, he was shipwrecked, he was always kind of in some sort of trouble. And yet all of the ones I've mentioned rose above their troubles and their difficult circumstances to rejoice and be glad always in the Lord. And therefore, there's a lesson for us, of course, in all of these stories, a kind of models to follow that, even though I would suggest that maybe our lives are not perfect either, I'm sure they are not. Maybe once in a while they are, but we have problems, of course. We know the world is in various, many serious problems, maybe individual problems among ourselves as well, personal problems. And we don't have all the answers. So we can kind of dwell on that, or we can choose either to go around feeling self-pity for ourselves, and let this self-pity control our lives, or we can, on the other hand, see the hand of God in our lives and trust in his loving care as Mary and Isaiah and the others did as well, and know and realize that we are not alone, that, of course, this is a better and the safer and better way to go. It is, again, in a sense, the most wonderful time of the year, and I hope that you all will have a very wonderful season, of course. But it's wonderful because the Son of God came into the world to become one of us and consequently redeem us. And that makes all the difference in the world, the fact that Christ was born into the human race. So therefore, St. Paul rejoices, or suggests and urges us to rejoice always. And then he adds, he says, this is God's will. We sometimes wonder, what is God's will for us? And Paul says, the God's will is that we should rejoice. It's almost like a law. It's almost like a commandment. So that's kind of an amazing statement that he made, to rejoice always, in spite of sometimes very difficult circumstances. So may we respond to this Christmas season, Christ, earth, and so on, with gratitude and generosity, and a sense, a renewed sense of trust in the Lord. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.